The medieval world, medieval philosophers, did know about Plato. They did use many of his ways of thinking. Just to give you one example, we'll meet it later, the idea that God had a mind and had ideas, Platonic ideas, was derived ultimately from Plato. Not necessarily directly, but ultimately from Plato. So it is not true, as you sometimes will hear, that the Renaissance was the rebirth of Plato, as if Plato had been dead. He had not. He had existed, but he had existed in a certain altered form. He wasn't, as it were, the Plato that you and I would now recognize. There was only one work that was known, or used at least, by Plato, and even that was not complete. That is the Timaeus. And that was, as I say, in an incomplete form, and it had a commentary. But none of the other works that were associated most famously with Plato nowadays, the Phaedo, the Republic, the Platonus, there was no Latin translation, and there were no Greek manuscripts for people to consult in the Middle Ages. So although Plato was a name that was known, he was known mainly through other channels than through his own works, and principally through Aristotle, because as you know, Aristotle spent most of his life criticizing Plato. So it was, as I say, a very different Plato from the Plato that we knew. But nevertheless, it was an important Plato. There are bits of Plato that are important in the Middle Ages too. And Ficino knew this as well. So bear that in mind as a kind of preliminary observation. The second point comes with the, shall we call it, for convenience, the rebirth of Plato, the Platonic corpus, during the course of the 15th century, when various authors, both Greek and Latin, Italian Latin authors, started to translate Plato's works, the ones that had not been translated before, and make them available. Some of you may have read a book by a friend of mine called James Hankins, Plato in the Renaissance, where this wonderful story is recounted about how suddenly, in just a matter of about 70 years, people had all of the works nearly of Plato in Latin available to them for the first time. I mean, to us it doesn't sound particularly special, but it's rather like suddenly having discovered a huge treasure trove of manuscripts belonging to the Dead Seas or something that had never been there before. And suddenly you see the things that you knew were there but could never really understand. So this was a very important moment for the development of Western, or shall we call it Latin Christendom. And if we want to say there's a beginning, and there are no such things as beginnings, as you know, you can attribute it to Manuel Chrysoloras, who was a Byzantine who came from Constantinople to Italy, and he taught many of the most important Renaissance humanists, early humanists, during the beginning, the first decades of the 15th century. And I mentioned a few names: Gianozzo Minetti, Francesco Spilelfo, Rispo, Travessare, Perotti. It's all of the famous scholars. And he introduced this new line in translating Platonic works into Latin. There's a second very important moment in this prelude to Marsilio Ficino, and that is the historical circumstances of Christendom in the 15th century, the fall of Constantinople, and the attempts beforehand of the Eastern Church to make an alliance with the Western Church as a means to protect itself from Islam. So here is a map just to quickly give you the kind of sense of urgency that Christendom felt. This is a picture of the Caliphate in 750. The coloured areas here in Sudan are Islam. And over the course of the next 600 years, the Caliphate started to expand into what was left of the Byzantine Empire up here. So by 1450, very little remained. This is all of the Ottoman Empire. The Byzantine Empire is reduced to this, and Trebizond, and the rest belongs to Venice and Genoa. So virtually nothing remains in terms of territorial possessions of the original empire at the beginning or the middle of the 15th century. Yet nevertheless, the great cultural patrimony of Byzantium was still recognized by the Latin world. And that was partly because of the extensive contacts that the Venetians, in particular, but other Latin peoples had. So, although Byzantium was almost non-existent politically and as a military force, its cultural prestige was enormous. And it made these desperate attempts to try and save itself through its cultural patrimony. It had no real military strength left to withstand the Islamic onslaught, which eventually, as you know, in 1453, Constantinople fell. What all of this meant was that the East and the West started to engage in kind of serious, what I think theologians call serious dialogue about how to reconcile their differences, their theological differences. Theological differences were strange to us, well, perhaps not strange to us, small, or apparently small, theological differences had prevented these two churches from speaking to each other in a profound way for a long time. And one of the great differences, and this is important for what I will say tomorrow, one of the great differences was the Trinity. I mean, to many of you, this will sound extraordinary that we should envisage two worlds based on this distinction, but it was. The Trinity in the Latin conception was a triangle. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And they're equal. You could turn them up the other way around. There is not, as it were, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, a procession, which is what the Byzantine Church held as its main, one of its main dogmas. Now that, to us, kind of abstruse theological difference, as they say, was of immense importance, and it was debated at great length during the course of the 15th century when the two churches tried to meet and find a common ground. All of which meant that there were these extensive connections between the Byzantine world and the Latin world, and for our purposes, this is how Plato also comes to the Latin world, because a Byzantine theologian knows Plato. He knows Plato better than he knows Aristotle. Byzantine theology is much more Platonic, if I could put it simply, than Latin theology of this time. So you're seeing not just the translation of Plato's works happening at this time, but also a greater appreciation through theological context of Platonic interpretations of Christian theology. So, finally we come to Ficino. He can't see very clearly, he's here. This is a fresco in Florence by Ghirlandaio, the Vincitani over here, and here three learned men, three learned Greeks. Landino. Ah, yes, thank you.
No.
Will you go to sleep? Here is Poliziano, Landino, and Cino. These are people who, these are scholars who, you can't say work for the Medici, but the Medici rather like they give money for fresco cycles or tombs or sculptures. They will give money to people like Marsilio Ficino, Landino to write books for them. And Marsilio Ficino came to the attention of Cosimo de' Medici, because one of Cosimo de' Medici's doctors was Marsilio Ficino's father. Cosimo de' Medici was a great promoter of the attempts to reconcile the Byzantine church and the Latin church. And yet many of the Byzantine theologians speak in Greek, but thanks to my translator, translated into Latin, translated into Latin so that the people like Cosimo could understand what the Byzantine theologians were saying. And Cosimo was very fascinated by the Byzantine theologians and what they had to say, and about their ideas about Plato, as well as Aristotle. As a result, at quite a young age, Marsilio Ficino was born in 1433, but when Marsilio Ficino was, roughly speaking, 30 or so, 33 years, he comes to the attention of Cosimo through his father, because of his great linguistic aptitude, like yours, and he gives him the task of becoming a Greek scholar. Now, you know how, at least I know how difficult Greek is. You may find it easy, but I find Greek a challenging language even now, although I can read it competently, but it's still a difficult language. Reading Plato is not the easiest author. If you start to read somebody like Plotinus or Proclus or Syrianus or Iamblichus in Greek, and you have no good translations at all, you have no really good dictionaries, and you have no grammars, you can imagine how difficult this is. I would call it impossible. However, Marsilio Ficino was clearly a very gifted Greek scholar by nature, and within 3 or 4 years he was able to translate very complicated texts that even a modern Greek scholar would find difficult. So the Medici, Cosimo in the first place, but then subsequently the famous Lorenzo de' Medici, give him what every scholar dreams of, 33 years of research scholarship. You're lucky if you get 1 year now. 33 years. Magnificent. So, Marsilio Ficino spends his life, literally his life, translating Plato and the Platonic texts. Not just as his predecessors, Renaissance predecessors like Bruni and Aristo and others, who translated one small dialogue, or De Chimbra translated the Republic. Not just one small text by Ficino, but the whole of the Platonic corpus, and also all of Plotinus. A lot of Proclus, a lot of Iamblichus, and a lot of other authors too. It is quite staggering to believe that somebody could do this, quite frankly. And what is even more extraordinary, and this is not my judgment, I asked somebody who's a much better Platonist than I am, I asked him this question just 2 weeks ago, I said, is it your impression that Ficino understood Plotinus when he first started using him in 1460, that is before he wrote the De Amore? Or is it that he gradually understood him and used bits, and then when he translated him and then wrote a commentary on him, then he understood him? And this man I asked is called Stephen Gersh. He's a very reputable ancient Greek Platonist scholar. He said, no, he understood him from the very beginning, all of it. And that was my impression too. And so I was very gratified to hear. And it is quite extraordinary to think that anybody could do this. I don't understand how they do it. So I just leave it to my admiration to Marsilio Ficino. I don't hero worship him. I don't find him an attractive personality. But the intellectual achievement was really quite extraordinary to be able to accomplish this task. And as I say, he translated all of Plato, retranslated all of Plato, I should say, all of Plotinus and most of the famous Platonic texts of the time.
Ergo, ec hoc monet ut bene professor, media aetate, quod plenumque auditur, media aetate nomen Platonis non fui sepeltus de letum, ut saepe laudimus. Philosophi media aetate sane noverant Platonem, noverant eius nomen, non nulla etiam eius philosophiae manaverant in philosophiam Christianam, portasse non recta a Platonis opendus, sed oblique etiam per seu, per filosofos Christianos, seu per ipsum Aristotelem, cui magnam vitae suae partem collocabit in castigando Platone, utilitat dicam. Ergo, hoc est primum dicendum, philosophi media aetate novelant opus quodam Platonis, presertim per commentarium, illes novelant timaeum. Noveran commentarium calcidi ultimaeum, ergo poterant legere, haec quidem, poterant aliquomodo delibare in philosophiam, se non penitus percipere eam. Itaque cum locum de Platone renato, utita dixerim, de Platone redivivo, oporteat in primis spectare ad a convivium, il est ad Emanuele Chrysoloram, qui principia us rei delici, possumus doque de principis, nam de qui professor nus quam sunt bella principia. Sed tamen ille primus qui russus resuscitat ad quotius indidit institutionem linguae grecae in Europam latinam, in partem Europae, quae latinam ecclesiam spectabat. Videbis hic nomina, non ullorum vistibulorum, qui fortasse sunt praeceteris egregi, sicut Franciscus Filericus, Iantus Manetti, et etiam Guarinus Veronensis, alico multi, quor nomina vobis fortasse non sunt ignota. Hoc itaque potesse sediam de his rebus plura scire, et plura legere in opere, et quod scripsit James Hankins, Jacobus Hankins, scripsit professor in Universitate Harvardiana, cui vocatur de Platone aetatur anantarum artium aetatis, aetatur anantarum artium. Illes amicus professoris et scripsit hoc volumen palmare satis magnum in quo per seculum an totam historiam. Comodo intra spatium centum annorum omnia opera Platonis sint in lucem reportata, europeis, qui in parte latina, literalmente. Bene, ergo, cum de la questione lo quamur, preterire non possumus aliam renque eo tempore fiebat, videlicet quo in periculo versaretur Constantinopolis et in universum imperium Byzantinum, seu id quod imperium Byzantini restiterat. Vidistis duas cartas geograficas, quam altera, quam altera nobis monstrat quantum dilatatum fuerit imperium musulmanorum, des principatus musulmanorum, seculo VIII. Sed non multis seculis post videtis multas alias terras esse in rum imperium redactas, et imperium Byzantinum esse altissimis, iam minimis pane finibus coartatum. Itaque Byzantium, si spectamus ad abim, quam in ceteras gentes et in orbem terram habebat, pane nidiam habebat. Tamen aduc respicebatur, tamquam lumen doctrinarum et literarum. Itaque hoc coedit et latinos et grecos, ut tandem aliquando descenderet in quasi campum unionis ecclesiae, et est tandem aliquando disputarent de ecclesiis, de utraque ecclesia in unum coniungenda, et de solvendis illis questionibus theologicis, quibus diu dissederant et dissenserant inter se orthodoxi et latini. Caput et prima anum questionum fui questio de Trinitate. Et recte dicit professor, nobis cortasse hoc videri minum, posse duas orbis terrarum partes, tantopere dissidere propter questionem de Trinitate. Et imo ille pulcre etiam explicum hoc pane ratione quadam quasi geometrica. Id est apud latinos, Trinitas abetur prope triangulum, nam Deus Pater, Deus Filius et Spiritus Sanctus abentur paene pari gradu eius quemque divinitatis. Cum autem apud orthodoxos res potius interrogatur tamquam processio a Patria, ad Filium et ad Spiritum Sanctum. Itaque hoc apud eius sum erat momenti et erat prima questio absolvenda in his disputationibus. Hoc multum facit ad questionem de Platone redivivo, nam theologi Byzantini multo melius novelant Platonem quam Aristotelem. Theologia, tota theologia orthodoxa, magis nititur placitis Platonis quam Aristotelis, ut eo tempore erant. Itaque per han questionem theologicam, etiam philosophia Platonis permanabit ad partes occidentales. Ergo, intanto mi sumatim, dicam, credo vos lera qua interexisse, et disse in tabula ulius dramatis didalicam quasi primas personas. Vedistis enim Marsilium Ficinum in opere parietali a Ghirlandaio facto. Vedistis Marsilium Ficinum, vedistis etiam Angelo Politianum, vedistis Christophorum Landinum, vedistis etiam primores ius gentis mediciae, medici. Qui fuerunt qui sumis eladitionibus et etiam magno auxilio pecuniae, sustinuerunt Marsilium Ficinum, multosque alios artifices et vilos doctos, ut condeent ida maetatem quam nos vocamus renatar martium aetatem. Marsilius Ficinus in familiaritatem ius cosmi in primis ed in laurenti venit quod eius pater dioteticus Ficinus esset medicus aulicus cosmi. Itaque commendatus eis a patre et cosmus statim eius lingua et peritiam adamabit atque admiratus est, itaque ei tradidit munus convertendi Platonis in primis, sed etiam Plotini et adiorum oculorum Platonicorum. Ut facetis, professor, nos nunc solemus sum opere gaudere cum mecenatis nostri temporis, elargiuntur nobis unum stipendium academicum unius anni. Sed Marsilius Ficinus nactus est stipendium triginta annorum, triginta et trinum annorum, et da quei paine totam annam dedicari, per quei incerto. Marsilius Ficinus intellexit philosophos, sicur Plotinum, paine primo obtutu. Id est non, sicur mulum, sicur saepefit, non primum legit ed enne labente tempore intellexit gradatim, sed Ficinus videtur quasi quadam lumine revelationis tactus, videtur statim intellexisse. Et idem admiranda est eius peritia in convertendo cum caduerit omnio subsidio lexicorum et grammaticarum, quibus nos nunc temporis abundamus. ergo etiamsi professor multis in rebus, portasse non precipue veneratur Marsilium vicinum ut omnem, tamen admiratur eius ingenium, qui per cui il portuare è tam bene, et tam quito presertim, e a exaltare quae multi omnes per saecula manaviera, anche già fuorant, non dicam modes magnomenti, anche già fuorant quidam interpretes Platonis, sicut Leonardus Bruni Aretinus, qui paru catantum convertirant, Marsilius Ficinus totum corpus, Platonicum convertit in latinum sermonem.